Good evening, everyone. Thank you all for joining in on tonight's event. My name is Keen Richards from Nome, and I work as UAF Northwest Campus Village Program Specialist, and I use he or his pronouns. I'm really excited and honored to be a part of this series and assisting as your facilitator tonight. I just want to start by acknowledging that those at our Troth Yedha campus in Fairbanks are on the unceded customary lands of the Dena people of the Tanana River. In Nome, we are Inupiat, Yupik, and Siberian Yupik lands. We honor the continued fight for the rights of our first peoples, and we stand with them in solidarity and action. At UAF, we are growing our institution into a socially just and caring institution of higher education. So this ongoing speaker series known as Shine a Light, Promoting Conversations on Diversity, Equity, and Inclusion is designed to encourage understanding, to build empathy, and engage us all in thinking critically about our worldviews. The series is led by Northwest Campus, but like all great diversity efforts, there are many partnerships and collaborations, and we would like to thank UAF Department of Equity and Compliance and Nanook Diversity and Action Center for partnering with the Northwest Campus to bring this series to reality. Thank you. We've hosted several excellent topics throughout this series, such as discussions on Black history in Alaska, women's history with a focus on Alaska Native women. You can find those recordings on our website, nwc.uaf.edu. I'm really excited for tonight's discussion titled The Complexities of Anti-Asian Racism. So joining us will be Dr. David. He obtained his bachelor's degree in psychology from the University of Alaska Anchorage in 2002, and his Master of Arts in 2004, and his doctorate degree in 2007, and then degrees in clinical community psychology from the University of Illinois at Urbana-Champaign. He's currently a tenured professor of psychology at the University of Alaska in Anchorage, with his primary duties being with the PhD program in clinical community psychology that has a rural, cultural, and indigenous emphasis. We hope you join us each month as we navigate through different topics. Please use the chat option at the bottom of your screen to ask any questions that EJ may be able to address at the end of his speech. And without further ado, please welcome EJ David.
Okay. Good evening, everybody. Thanks for that introduction, Keen. All right. So I'm going to introduce myself here a little bit more. But again, I just want to say good evening to you all. I hope you're all doing well. You know, it's a very challenging world out there right now for a variety of reasons. And I hope you all have caring and loving people around you that are holding you up. As Keen mentioned, my name is EJ David, and I'm thrilled to be here. Thank you to Mariah, to Barb, to Keen, to Joe, Laura, and the rest of the Northwest Campus for inviting me to share some of my thoughts on this topic here tonight. It's really a great honor to share this space with all of you. And for those of you who are tuned in, thank you for choosing to spend some of your time listening to me. I deeply appreciate it. And as you can see right here with the title, I am going to share some of my thoughts on anti-Asian racism. But before I do that, as I do with every talk, I must first do some acknowledgments. First, I want to acknowledge my ancestors. Although I identify as a Filipino immigrant man, you know, and as it is what is most familiar to people, the term Filipino really is a colonial name. The peoples in the islands now known as the Philippines are very diverse. There are many ethnic and cultural groups throughout the islands. My ancestors are Kapampangan and Tagalog, which means people of the riverbanks and people of the river, respectively. And so it is them who I must acknowledge tonight. It is them who are with me. I also must acknowledge my family. My wife is Koyukon Athabascan from the village of Ruby by the Yukon River. Together, we have four children. You see three of them in this photo. Their names are Malakas, Kalayaan, Kaluguran, and the fourth one, the freshest one, is Tala. And again, even though you don't see them here physically with me, they are always with me. I am a reflection of my family. Finally, I want to acknowledge that I'm joining you all from the traditional lands of the Dena'ina people, the Gayakak, otherwise known as Anchorage. It is here where I live and work at the University of Alaska, Anchorage. And then lastly, before I begin, I also want to preface my presentation with the fact that my work is deeply influenced by my own personal experiences and identity as a Filipino man. And so many of the examples that I will share here with you tonight will be using the Filipino experience as an illustrative case. All right, so let's begin. As we all have witnessed over the past year, anti-Asian racism has significantly increased. A peer-reviewed scientific study showed that implicit bias against Asians increased after March 2020, when political leaders and other authority figures insisted on calling the coronavirus the Wuhan virus or the Chinese virus or Kung Flu. And, you know, although implicit bias doesn't necessarily result into acts, in this case, I think it's more than just coincidence that we also saw a rise in anti-Asian violence over the past year, right? With the estimate being that there's been like 150% increase in reports of anti-Asian racism. And because of, you know, this, the national and even international spotlight has been shifted toward Asian Americans' experiences of racism. And this doesn't happen very often. In fact, Asian Americans have long complained that their experiences of racism are often forgotten, unacknowledged, neglected, or if even considered at all, they're often minimized. And Alaska isn't immune to anti-Asian racism. In our states, we have a big Asian Alaskan population. After white folks and after Native folks, Asians are the third largest racial group in our state. Asians also are the largest immigrant group in Alaska, outside of white folks. You know, my sister Ayu Kasatak always likes to point out to me that no, EJ, Asians are not the largest immigrant group in the state. White people are. So I always have to point that out. So in Alaska, right? You know, as big as the Asian Alaskan population is, half of that Asian Alaskan population are Filipinos. And Filipinos also compose the largest non-white immigrant group in Alaska. So Alaska is unique from most other states in the country in that, again, our third largest racial group here in Alaska is Asian, instead of, you know, in other states it's usually African Americans or Latinx folks. And then our largest immigrant group or non-white immigrant group in Alaska are Asian, right? Filipinos specifically. Whereas in other states, the largest immigrant groups are usually Latinx people or Mexicans specifically. So the increasing anti-Asian violence throughout the country is highly relevant to us here in Alaska. In fact, a 2019 study that I conducted with my colleagues at UAA, Dr. Gabriel Garcia and Dr. Joy Mapaye, we found that 54%, so approximately one out of two Asian Alaskans experience racism. So again, Asian Americans have been yearning to get the spotlight on their experiences as racialized people, as minoritized people, as oppressed people for a very long time. And this past year, we seem to finally see some changes. Lately, with the spotlight on anti-Asian racism, more and more people are saying things like, "I see you." I see this on social media. I myself have received this sentiment from friends and acquaintances. You know, texts, emails, saying, I see you. And, I guess that's something, right? I get, but because it's at least it's an acknowledgement, that something is happening in our society. But I often wonder, do they really see me? Do they really see my peoples? Do they really see us accurately? And so now that we finally have people's attention, right, including those who are in positions of power and privilege, like the media, influential celebrities, even politicians, even corporations, now that we finally have a share of the spotlight, perhaps it's time to also break out our magnifying glasses. Now that the world seems to finally acknowledge that Asian Americans also face racism, perhaps it's time to also make sure that we, right, and really the rest of the world, not just see us, but see us accurately in all our variations, in all our uniqueness, and in all our complexities. So I think it's time for a closer, more detailed, and more nuanced look at anti-Asian racism. And so here for the next, about 40 minutes or so, I want to just quickly share with you some of these nuances to anti-Asian racism that I think are important for us to know as we, attempt to address this issue. So nuance number one, anti-Asian racism is American tradition. And as you can see there in parentheses, it says with a twist. And I'll get to that twist later. Okay, let's just focus on the first part for now. So many folks, scholars, celebrities, community leaders, activists, they've been saying that anti-Asian racism has been around forever. However, it took a tragedy like, the Atlanta murders a couple of months ago, and then, what happened in Indianapolis shortly after that, for many Americans to finally pay attention. And a lot of Americans seem to be even shocked with the rise of anti-Asian racism, even calling them un-American, but we need to be very clear. Anti-Asian racism is very American. And anti-Asian racism isn't new. This has been going on for at least 150 years. And to prove this, many folks have been, really screaming about popular examples. So many of you all may have heard of the Chinese Exclusion Act of 1882. Some folks have been also talking about the colonialism of the Philippines in the late 1800s, because Americans saw Filipinos as uncivilized savages needing to be Christianized, educated, and civilized. Some folks, might also mention the assaults and the murders and the lynchings and the bombings of Filipino farm workers in, the Western states in the early 1900s by white terrorists. Many people might also know about the internment of Japanese Americans during World War II, because anybody of Japanese descent, including children at that time, were seen as spies or were seen as unloyal to the United States. Many people also talk about, the United States imperialist wars in the Philippines, Cambodia, Vietnam, Korea, where Americans killed millions of Asians. So anti-Asian racism has a long history in America. But when we talk about this long history, though, we often provide these examples from like the 1800s or, all the way to the early to mid 1900s. Things that for many people happened a long time ago. And so maybe this contributes to why so many people, even those who might concede that maybe there is such a thing as anti-Asian racism, they nevertheless think that anti-Asian racism is nothing but a thing of the past. Right, and that it's no longer an issue today. And so maybe we need to remind folks that anti-Asian racism isn't just all in the past. Perhaps we need to remind people that there are plenty of anti-Asian racism examples in our recent history. For example, This was back in 2016 when a New York Times editor shared his experience of racism. His open letter to the woman who told his family to go back to China was one of the most read stories of 2016 and sparked the "This is 2016" hashtag that went viral. As Asian Americans throughout the country shared their experiences of racial microaggressions. This spurred at least a couple of other efforts to hear Asian American experiences with racism. This one was an 8-minute video produced by the New York Times. Again, focused specifically on anti-Asian racism. And again, back then this was huge because Asian American community doesn't usually get this much attention. Here's another one, again, produced by the New York Times also. This is about a 7.5-minute video. Again, focused on Asian Americans' experiences of racism. And here, you know, if you look closely, you might notice Hasan Minhaj is one of the people that was part of this short documentary. You know, and this was before, you know, Hasan Minhaj, you know, really blew up and became famous, right? But again, this is not from a long time ago. This is like now. Okay, this is recent. And as you know, some of you might remember, this was just in 2017 in Kansas, two Asian Indian men were shot by a white man who yelled, you know, get out of my country, killing one of them. Then there was the Sikh temple massacre in Oak Creek, Wisconsin. This was just in 2012, where, you know, six Asian Indians were killed. And the shooter was a known white supremacist. And then this was, this is, you know, since 2001, after the 9/11 attacks, South Asian Americans Leading Together, or SALT, which is a community organization, they've been tracking racist attacks and hate crimes and racist policies also against South Asian, Sikh, Hindu, Muslim, Middle Eastern and Arab Americans, and there has been plenty. Then there's Joseph Eleto, a Filipino-American postal worker who was on the job when he was shot and killed by a white supremacist in 1999 in Los Angeles, California. There was also the case of Vincent Chin, a Chinese-American man who was brutally murdered in 1982 by two white men in Michigan because of, you know, the growing Japanese auto industry. It was beginning to affect white folks in Michigan's employment and economic stability. The murderers received only 3 years of probation. Then many people may not know about this, but back in 1989 in Stockton, California, a white man shot up Cleveland Elementary School, killing 5 school children and wounding 32 others. All 5 children who died and many who were wounded were Cambodian and Vietnamese refugees. And so, yeah, anti-Asian racism is an American tradition. Violence that stems from white supremacy isn't new to Asian Americans. As a matter of fact, it is white supremacist violence that brought many Asian Americans here to this country as colonized peoples, as refugees of American wars, or as immigrants looking for ways to survive because the US stole our resources and exploited and ravaged our homelands and made living and surviving there very difficult. So no, anti-Asian racism isn't new. White supremacist violence against Asians isn't new. And it isn't just a thing of the past. It was, it has been, and it still is a thing today. Anti-Asian racism is quintessentially American. And furthermore, you know, as we were just talking about right here, Americans don't even remember things that happened just 30 years ago, or 20 years ago, 8 years ago, or 5 years ago, or even 3 years ago. You know, it's probable that what happened over the past year with the rise in anti-Asian racism and what happened in Atlanta just a couple of months ago, it's very probable that that will also be forgotten soon. You know, America's memory when it comes to remembering anti-Asian racism is remarkably short. And so here's the twist that I alluded to earlier. In addition to anti-Asian racism being an American tradition, we must also remember that forgetting, disregarding, and minimizing anti-Asian racism is itself an American tradition. And because anti-Asian racism has been happening for a very long time, the next nuance about anti-Asian racism that I want to highlight is anti-Asian racism's impact on Asian Americans is threefold. And then again, parentheses, plus one. And that's a big plus one. I'll get to that one later. Let's focus on the threefold part first. A lot of the discussion surrounding the impact of anti-Asian racism recently has focused on racism that's going on now, or at least the past year, right? But recent racism. Again, this is understandable as this seems most pressing. You know, given recent rise in anti-Asian racism, many Asian Americans today have been feeling anxious, fearful, afraid to go out in public. Many Asian Americans have been feeling sad and depressed or angry and enraged even. Many have been feeling numb or just, you know, feeling like they're stuck and can't think clearly. All of this are valid reactions to racism and traumatic events. These mental health effects are not surprising because the research on how racism affects peoples of color is clear. Racism can lead to poor mental health, trauma, poor self-esteem, lower life satisfaction, substance use even, suicidal ideation. It can also lead to difficulty sleeping, difficulties concentrating, difficulties thinking or focusing on things that we need to do, being unable to function in our daily lives. It can affect our work performance. It can affect our school performance and our relationships. But peoples of color don't just deal with the racism that, you know, they directly experience. They're also forced to deal with the racist experiences that, you know, their friends and family face. But not only that, you know, they also feel the racist experiences faced by other people who they don't even know, but who look like them, right? Or who they have a shared identity with. So, you know, if they see someone who look like them get treated badly, you know, that vicarious oppression affects them as well. Right. So, you know, when we see maltreatments of our people, when we see on TV how our people are dehumanized and othered and inferiorized or terrorized or murdered, we feel that. It activates our fight or flight systems too. It makes us anxious, stressed out, even scared, maybe even depressed too. We lose sleep because of that too. We don't need to directly experience racism to be negatively affected by it, right? These vicarious racist experiences can be traumatizing to us as well. And to take this concept of vicarious racism even further, you know, the racist experiences of our ancestors also affect us today. You know, as we just talked about during nuance number one, how, you know, white supremacist violence against Asians has happened throughout history. So we must also understand that such historical racism also impacts Asian Americans today. Historical trauma and its effects can be passed down to later generations. There's plenty of psychological research on this and some emerging epigenetic research that supports this. So all of those historical experiences of racism, of colonialism, of imperialism, of war, that regarded our communities as savages, as uncivilized, as inferior, as less than human. Those messages that, you know, that damaged and messed up our ancestors, they can still inflict damages on us today, several generations later. So it's really three different kinds of anti-Asian racism that are bombarding Asian American mental health right now. It's not just the recent and direct racism that we experience, there's also the historical and vicarious racism. And because we have been surrounded by so much dehumanizing and inferiorizing messages throughout history, vicariously and directly, combined with nuance number one, the twist part, you know, that we've been repeatedly gaslighted by forgetting, disregarding, and minimizing our experiences of racism, many of us end up internalizing these oppressive messages and have succumbed to them, coming to accept and believe that perhaps our peoples are indeed inferior. And this is the big plus one I was referring to earlier. Today, many Asian Americans might feel ashamed or embarrassed of our ethnicities. Many of us might feel ashamed of our brown skin, or many of us might use skin whitening products or straighten our hair or try to get rid of our almond-shaped eyes. Many of us might look down on other people in our same communities, be hostile to them, inflict violence on those who we think are not Americanized enough. We call them fobs. We make fun of their accents, and we regard them as backwards or less intelligent. Many of us might even get to the point where we minimize the oppressive experiences that we faced, thinking that such oppression is okay, because at least we're here in the United States. And so we should just work harder on our accents and work harder on our math homework and work harder on our jobs and work harder on being American and work harder on becoming white, so that we can avoid racism. Many of us have become convinced that, you know, the closer we are to whiteness, then the better off we will be. And many of us have come to believe that our success and even our survival depend on how much we understood and adopted whiteness. And so, you know, sure, right? The damages of direct, vicarious, and historical racism include many mental health consequences: psychological distress, trauma, low self-esteem, anxiety, depression, substance use, even suicide. But the effects of racism also include, you know, loss of culture, loss of pride, loss of connection to our ancestors, loss of identity, loss of who we are, loss of connection with our peoples in our community, therefore putting us in a vulnerable position to replace what was our own with what this society tells us is better, putting us in a very vulnerable position to accept white supremacy. So in addition to, and as a consequence of being bombarded by historical, vicarious, and direct racism, many Asian Americans also have to contend with internalized racism. You know, and this is probably the most insidious consequence of anti-Asian racism. The next nuance I want to discuss is anti-Asian racism may look different for different Asian people. There's been a long-standing but inaccurate narrative that Asian equals East Asian or Chinese, Japanese, or Korean. However, as many of us know, the Asian American population is very diverse. When we look at current demographics, Chinese, Koreans, and Japanese Americans combine to compose only around 38% of the Asian American population. This means that a majority of Asian Americans, at least 6 out of 10, are not East Asian. Asian Indians, Filipinos, and Vietnamese, those three groups alone combine to compose half of the Asian American population. And, you know, as we know, interpersonal racism, or racism that happens between people, which is what we often think of when we think of racism, it's highly dependent on physical features or phenotypes, because interpersonal racism is driven by what race a person is perceived to be. And although there might be some overlap, for example, some Filipinos and Vietnamese folks might have East Asian physical features or might have East Asian heritage themselves. You know, we must remember that there are important differences in phenotypes among different Asian groups in general that can influence the types of racism that they are likely to experience. So let's break out our magnifying glasses and dive into this a little bit more closely. According to the literature on racial prototypicality bias, people with physical features that are perceived as typical of their racial group tend to be treated more negatively, meaning they are subjected to more discrimination that are based on the stereotypes associated with the racial group. And so to this theory, right, data collected by the wonderful folks at AAPI Data, which is an amazing organization, it suggests that a lot of people, like around 50% of people, tend to not see Indians, Pakistanis, and Middle Eastern people as Asians. In contrast, their data also shows that people tend to see Chinese, Koreans, and Japanese people as clearly Asian, right? So Asian Indians, Pakistanis, Middle Eastern folks, not seen as Asian, but Chinese, you know, Koreans and Japanese clearly seen as Asian. Filipinos are perceived to be somewhere in the middle of East Asians and South Asians, right? So putting racial prototypicality bias theory together with this data right here, what this suggests is that different Asian American groups might experience different kinds of racism. And we see this clearly with the COVID-related racism reported by different Asian groups. So as you can see right here, with the data from the Stop AAPI Hate organization, you know, COVID-related racism seems to be mostly experienced by East Asians, Chinese, Koreans, Japanese, and Taiwanese. This is the data set that is most cited over the past year, right? This is the one that has gained the most attention from the media and the general population. This is the data set that brought the spotlight on anti-Asian racism during the COVID-19 pandemic. The association of virus to Asian Americans, right? This is the data set that really promoted that narrative. But as you can see right here, approximately 70% of reported COVID-related racism were experienced by Chinese, Taiwanese, Koreans, and Japanese people, right? Out of the almost 4,000 reports of COVID-related racism, right? There were zero reports from South Asians, you know? And you know, if we look at Filipinos, as you can see right there, although there are some Filipinos who have experienced COVID-related racism, around 8%, as you can see here, that's very low compared to their percentage of the Asian population, which is almost 20%. So again, this is consistent with racial phenotypicality bias theory in the data that we looked at in terms of how different Asian groups are perceived, right? Or who is perceived as Asian. And so what this data set tells us is that, East Asians or Asian Americans who identify with or are associated with, quote, you know, the yellow race, they're the ones who are especially affected by COVID-related racism. In contrast, Asian Americans who identify as brown, like, you know, the whole brown Asian category, seem to not be as impacted. However, it's important to note here, right, that this does not mean that brown Asians like South Asians, Filipinos, and Southeast Asians don't experience racism. It doesn't mean that they don't experience racism as often. And it doesn't mean that they don't report the racism that they experience. Instead, what this suggests is that brown Asians might be experiencing different kinds of racism, right? So let's look at data for that as well. So back in 2016, this was before the COVID-19 pandemic, the post-election National Asian American Survey asked around 4,400 Asian American adults about their experiences with 15 different kinds of racism. And in all of them, in all the 15 different kinds of racism, brown Asians generally reported more frequent experiences of racism than East Asians. So for example, as you can see right here, Filipinos, Indians, and Bangladeshis are the top three when it comes to experiencing being unfairly denied a promotion at work, right? But when in the COVID-related racism that we looked at a few slides ago, Filipinos only were at 8%, and Indians and Bangladeshis were at 0. Being unfairly fired, Indians, Bangladeshis, Pakistanis, Hmong, and Pakistanis are the top five. Being unfairly not hired, you have Indians and Bangladeshis reporting this most frequently. Being harassed or abused by police, we have Cambodians, Indians, Hmong, and Pakistanis experiencing this most frequently. Housing discrimination, we have Pakistanis, Indians, Bangladeshis, Cambodians, and Filipinos as the top five experiencing this type of racism most frequently. Experiencing discrimination from your neighbors, Hmong, Cambodians, Bangladeshis, and Pakistanis experience this most frequently. Receiving poor service at restaurants or stores, Filipinos, Hmong, Indians, Bangladeshis experience this most frequently. People assuming they don't speak English, Hmong, Filipino, Bangladeshis report this most often. Other people acting as if they're afraid of you, Bangladeshis, Pakistanis, Hmong, Indians, and Filipinos, and Cambodians experience this most frequently. Other people acting as if you are being dishonest or are untrustworthy. Hmong, Filipinos, Cambodians, Indians, Bangladeshis report this most often. Being called names or insulted. Filipinos, Hmong, and Bangladeshis experience this most often. Being threatened or harassed. Filipinos, Bangladeshis, Cambodians, and Hmong people experience this most frequently. So again, as you can see, it's not that brown Asians aren't experiencing racism or are experiencing lower levels of racism or are not reporting experiences of racism, you know, as suggested by the COVID-related data. It's just that their experiences of racism are not as strongly tied to the COVID-19 pandemic, like perhaps it is more so for East Asians. This is like how non-South Asians experiences of racism aren't tied to Islamophobia, like it is more so for South Asians, right? Or like how Filipinos experiences of racism are more likely to be linked with anti-Mexican or anti-Latinx sentiments and immigration because of phenotype, as suggested by racial prototypicality bias theory. So for example, in 2018, this Filipina woman who was working as a server in a restaurant in Virginia had a group of customers not leave her a tip and instead wrote on the receipt, "Build that wall, Trump daddy," likely thinking that she's Latina. Another example is in 2017 in Las Vegas. A woman was recorded on video spewing racist and hateful words toward her Filipino neighbor. Again, this is not a stranger, right? But a neighbor who lives next door and who knows where this Filipino man and his children and his family live. She said, "Go back to where you came from. We don't want you here." She told the Filipino man that he is from, again, these are quotes, "some piece of shh, Manila ass effing ghetto living under a tarp piece of shh land." She further called Filipinos, quote, "stupid savages who are just one effing generation out of the jungle, like loincloth wearers." And she went on to shout that Filipino women are nothing but sex workers, that Filipinos do nothing but populate the world with trashy people who suck resources out of America, and that Filipinos should be thankful to America for colonizing, civilizing, and protecting the Philippines. These examples from Las Vegas and the one from Virginia reflect the unique racialized and racism experiences of Filipinos in this country because of, again, phenotype, different histories, different cultures, different worldviews. Sometimes we're subjected to stereotypes and racism that are common among Asians. Sometimes it's stereotypes and racism faced by Latinx people. And then sometimes it's stereotypes and racism faced by indigenous peoples. So again, it's important to remember that the Asian American population is very diverse in terms of phenotype, culture, and history. This society has imposed different stereotypes, for different Asian groups. And because of this, different Asian groups will experience different kinds of racism. Another important thing to remember is that although all of our attention right now is on interpersonal racism, you know, like racial slurs, you know, violence between individuals, you know, that are reported on the media, we must also recognize how anti-Asian racism happens in the systemic level as well, which brings me to nuance number 4. Anti-Asian racism is not just interpersonal, it's systemic too. I alluded to some examples of this earlier with regard to all of the anti-Muslim policies that have been implemented since 9/11, things like the Muslim ban on immigration, you know, and there's the Patriot Act that some of you may be familiar with. But one example I want to focus on due to its timeliness, given the COVID-19 pandemic, is the case of Filipina nurses. So as you can see, Filipinos compose only 1% of the United States population, but compose 4% of all registered nurses. Also, 28% of immigrant nurses in the United States are from the Philippines, right? And this doesn't include the number of second or later generation Filipino Americans who are also nurses, right? Or who are other types of healthcare workers. In California, where 44% of the Filipino American population live, Filipinos compose 18% of all registered nurses in California. And then in New York, you know, which was very, you know, badly hit by COVID-19, if you remember, 30% of the Filipino American population there are nurses or other healthcare workers. So again, even if they are not nurses or healthcare workers themselves, many Filipino Americans personally know, the odds are they personally know someone who is a healthcare worker and therefore who might be exposed to COVID-19 daily at work. And so therefore, almost the entire Filipino American community is at higher risk for COVID exposure. Let's take a few steps back here real quick, though, to more critically understand how it came to be that Filipinos are overrepresented in nursing and healthcare, putting them at higher risk for COVID infection. Today, the Philippines is the world's largest exporter of nurses, with nearly 20,000 Filipino nurses leaving the Philippines every year to work in other countries, most of them coming to the United States, right? The overrepresentation of Filipinos in nursing did not just happen by accident, though, right? Or it's not a coincidence. It did not come out of nowhere. It's also not because of some nursing gene or healthcare worker gene making Filipinos more likely to enter these professions. You know, the high number of Filipino nurses in America today has colonial racist roots. So in her amazingly researched, powerful book, Dr. Catherine Siniza Choi traced the high numbers of Filipino nurses in the United States today to America's colonial relationship with the Philippines. Now, when the Philippines was a colony of the United States, the U.S. established Americanized schools in the Philippines that eventually evolved into Americanized nursing schools. And the U.S., because of its exploitation and wars, left the Philippine economy in a very fragile state, setting up the Philippines in such a way that people must leave in order to survive. And so structurally, many Filipinos end up having to come to the U.S. in order to survive while simultaneously draining the Philippines its own most valuable resource, its people. So this racist colonial roots have combined with changing immigration laws and more contemporary hiring practices and policies, you know, and really patriarchal sexist values about who should be working as nurses. And they all combine to systematically put Filipinos and other healthcare workers at increased risk of being infected by COVID-19. And we have data now coming out showing that over 30%, actually close to 1/3 of registered nurses in the US who have died because of COVID-19 are Filipino nurses. 30%. Again, Filipino nurses compose only 4% of the registered nurses in the US, but they compose 1/3 of those who died due to COVID-19. And so, yeah, we see more frequent interpersonal anti-Asian racism over the past year. And we've seen how interpersonal anti-Asian racism inflict harm and even death on Asian Americans. But we must also recognize how systemic anti-Asian racism have existed historically and contemporarily, and how systemic anti-Asian racism also inflict harm and death on Asian Americans. And I also want to highlight that it's not just the healthcare workers. Again, using Filipinos as an example, data shows that Filipinos are less likely to have a professional job than whites, and have, you know, and Filipinos also have or don't have a better chance of having professional or managerial jobs than Black workers. And so many Filipino Americans do not have the privilege of staying home or working from home during the pandemic. Right. Instead, many Filipinos work in airports, post offices, grocery stores, putting them in higher likelihood of COVID-19 exposure. So putting them at higher likelihood of contracting the disease. And then other research also shows that other factors like poverty, economic insecurity, and even like tenuous immigration status force many Filipino Americans to continue working even under unsafe conditions, again, putting them at higher risk for COVID-19 exposure. And we're seeing some data now that supports this in California and Hawaii, again, the two states where 50% of the Filipino American population live. In California, 35% of Asian American coronavirus deaths are Filipinos, you know, which puts them at a 40% mortality rate from COVID-19. The overall mortality rate of the virus is only like around 5%. But for Filipinos in California, it's around 40%. In Hawaii, more Filipinos have died of COVID than any other race. So again, you know, a lot of our attention right now is on interpersonal anti-Asian racism and violence, right? But we must also recognize how systemic anti-Asian racism also inflict harm and death on Asian Americans. And so what this suggests to us is that addressing anti-Asian violence, in our efforts to do so, we must also address the historical and contemporary systems and policies and structures that were set up, right, and are still operating today, right, that systematically inflict harm on Asians or put them at higher risk for suffering or death. And then lastly, the last nuance I want to highlight regarding anti-Asian racism is anti-Asian racism intersects with other types of oppressions. And we see this clearly today with COVID-related racism. For example, 2/3 of the almost 4,000 reports of anti-Asian racism over the past year were against women. And this didn't come out of nowhere, right? The gendered racism against Asian American women has long historical roots as well. Back in 1875, the Page Act banned Chinese women from immigrating to the US because they were seen as prostitutes and disease carriers. Over the decades since, the U.S. established military bases in various Asian countries where American soldiers exploited, sexualized, and objectified Asian women, you know, acting like they're entitled to have control over Asian bodies. But again, this is not just a thing of the past. We continue to live in a world where, for many decades now, Americans' exposure to Asian people are stereotypical, where our movies and TV shows and media portray Asian women as sex workers, as exotic, as hypersexualized, as docile and submissive, as objects really, and simply as bodies that, you know, really mostly white men are entitled to have control over. We also continue to live in a country where Asian women are stereotypically regarded as low-level service workers who are here to serve white people, to care for white people, and to meet white people's desires. You know, and again, this is not just a historical thing. A 2018 study by Asian American psychologists Shruti Mukamala and Karen Tsuyamoto showed that Asian American women today still commonly face stereotypes that have been around for at least 150 years, such as being exoticized and hypersexualized and being seen as submissive and being seen as a low-level service worker. Again, these stereotypes are driven by the intersections of racism and sexism or misogyny that our society has been fostering for over a century. And we are quite familiar with gendered racism here in Alaska. Here, you know, we are witness to a troubling example of the dangers and damages of the intersections of racism and sexism and misogyny in our state. In Alaska, we see this with the high numbers of missing and murdered Indigenous women and the high rates of violence against Native women. So Alaska is very familiar with gendered racism and is itself struggling with gendered racism, right? So what happened in Atlanta, you know, with the Asian American women who were murdered, can and absolutely does happen here in our state. Asian women in Alaska also tend to be devalued, disregarded, often stereotyped as low-level service workers, seen as exotic, hypersexualized. Also, Asian women in Alaska make only about 54 cents to every dollar that a white man makes. You know, and again, this is super low. So, you know, this wage gap showing that Asian women make the least is a sign of how devalued they are in this country in general, but in Alaska in particular. As many of us know, biases are learned and it's taught and instilled in us by our environment. If we live in a context where our exposure to Asian people are stereotypical, then that will shape our view of Asian people in a very biased way. That's just how biases are formed. It's based on a stereotypical, inaccurate, incomplete, distorted, and really dehumanizing view of who people are. And once you see people as less complete, as less whole, less human, then you're more likely to be violent toward them, right? And that's how dangerous biases are and how dangerous it is for our leaders and our society and our media to reinforce such biases. These words, jokes, right, stereotypes, they're not harmless. They hurt people. They inflict violence on people. They're deadly. And so what happened in Atlanta a couple of months ago is a tragic example of how dangerous racism is, particularly how dangerous gendered racism is, right? How dangerous the intersections of racism and misogyny and sexism and even classism are. For women of color in general, but for Asian women in particular. And again, this is not just an isolated incident, and this did not just come out of nowhere. This is a product of over a century of systematic and sustained fetishization, objectification, and dehumanization of Asian women. All right. Intersectionality is just reality. The reality is that oppression is multi-pronged. It comes in different forms and they exist and operate in multiple levels, and they can be subtle or blatant or intentional or unintentional. And they all intersect with each other and build off of each other to inflict harm, suffering, and death. And we need to see anti-Asian racism in this complex, multi-leveled, multifaceted, intersectional, real way. So in summary, now that we have a spotlight on Asian Americans' experiences of racism, we can now also break out our magnifying glasses to bring out hidden but important factors that influence our experiences. For a very long time now, Asian Americans have been fighting to address our invisibility and make the rest of the world see us. Specific to racism, we have been fighting forever for the rest of the world to listen to us and acknowledge us and believe us about our experiences of racism. Well, now that we have the spotlight, we should now also make the rest of the world not just see us, but see us accurately. You know, and these five nuances that I shared here with you all tonight can help us and the rest of the world, you know, more accurately understand and, you know, and really see Asian Americans' experiences of racism, but their experiences in general. So again, first, we must make sure that we understand how anti-Asian racism is American tradition. But not only that, we must also understand how forgetting, disregarding, and minimizing anti-Asian racism is American tradition as well. And because anti-Asian racism has been happening for a very long time, the kind of racism that is impacting Asian American well-being isn't just the racism that we experience today or experience directly. Instead, historical, vicarious, and direct racism all impact the mental health and well-being of Asian Americans. And given the depth and widespread nature of anti-Asian racism, many Asian Americans may develop internalized racism. And this is perhaps the most insidious consequence of racism. We must also remember that the Asian American population is very diverse and that different Asian peoples experience different kinds of racism. That although the attention right now is on COVID-related racism, this kind of racism seems to be more frequently experienced by East Asians. Other groups like South Asians and Filipinos might experience different kinds of racism because of different physical, cultural, and historical factors. Also, in relation to how our attention right now is on COVID-related racism, our attention right now also seems to be focused on interpersonal racism. But we must remember that anti-Asian racism isn't just interpersonal, it's systemic too. We see today the harms that interpersonal racism inflicts on Asian Americans, but systemic anti-Asian racism has also been going on for a very long time. And this systemic racism has been inflicting harms, suffering, and death on Asians for generations. Finally, we must remember the reality that anti-Asian racism intersects with other kinds of oppression. We must remember that intersectionality is the reality. And so to conclude, I just want to emphasize this. The Asian American category is a huge umbrella that is composed of a very diverse set of people. This becomes especially more so if we include Pacific Islanders in there, right? So again, I understand the value, perhaps even necessity, of such an alliance. There is strength in numbers, and so there's political power in this pan-ethnic identity. However, being in alliance and in solidarity with each other does not mean that we erase each other's uniqueness. It doesn't mean that we ignore our different realities. It doesn't mean that we simplify our complexities. It especially does not mean that we portray not just an incomplete picture of ourselves, but a grossly erroneous image of who we are as an alliance and what our lived experiences are. Being in alliance and being in solidarity doesn't mean that we buy into the stereotypes imposed on us or play the role that the dominant society wants us to play. We need to present ourselves as who we truly are for our issues, our voices, our strengths, and our needs to be accurately heard. We need to present our true experiences and realities. For a very long time now, Asian Americans have been fighting for a share of the spotlight. Now we seem to have it. Given the tendency of America to quickly forget about Asian Americans, though, we might not have it for very long, but we have a share of it now. So maybe that's a step. But spotlights can also be blinding, especially when we don't use it properly. So let's also break out our magnifying glasses and use the spotlight well. Let's use the spotlight to more clearly, accurately, and completely see Asian Americans and how unique, varied, and complex our experiences are. And I hope these five reminders I shared with you today help with this effort. Maraming maraming salamat. thank you all for listening.
Okay, there, I think I got that to work. Sorry, I was muted. Thanks so much, EJ, for your time and that presentation. That was wonderful. We're now going to address some questions that came in during the presentation. So let's jump to one. There were kind of a two questions that came in related to schooling, and I think the second one kind of best maybe phrases the first one as well. So the question is, is racism in part a result of the history lessons taught in American K through 12 schools, where there's a lack of authentic representation of BIPOC contribution and a commemorative version of American history?
Oh yeah, definitely. I think that's a big part of it. I think it perpetuates racism and it breeds racism. Like I said earlier, you know, our environment, our context plays a huge part in what we believe about different groups of people. And, you know, and if our environment, if our context, if, you know, our leaders, if people who we see as authority figures, if people that we look up to, people who we consider as, you know, knowledgeable, people we consider as mentors or role models, if those are where these inaccurate dehumanizing messages are coming from, then we are very likely to be shaped by that, right? And so, yeah, definitely. Our educational system is a huge part of this problem. I strongly recommend reading my sister Ayuka Satak's recent op-ed on the Anchorage Daily News about the educational systems. Contribution to racism. Hey, I see my friend John Gonzalez on the chat. Thanks for coming, John.
Keen, for some reason, can't unmute himself now.
Is that what we're waiting for?
another question. So you have a lot of comments coming in. Dan White shared that your presentation, EJ, was very valuable. Mary Burtness, excellent. Thank you. Kate Broberg, thank you, EJ. Another question, if you have time, EJ. Have you done any research measuring colonial mentality among Alaska Native peoples, or have you done the same research more recently to determine if people are manifesting colonial manifestation at a higher or lower rate compared to your 2006 results?
Okay. Who's asking that question? Sounds like somebody who's read some of my work before.
That one came from director Barb Amarok.
Oh yes. It's always been one of my it's always been a research question that I've had in the back of my mind for years now, is to develop, you know, a quantitative scale to try to capture internalized racism among different populations, you know, Alaska Natives being one of them. But, you know, I'm looking for collaborators, because I don't want to do it by myself. So if you want to collaborate with me, I would love to. But, you know, no, you know, to a brief response, response to your answer, has it gone down? The, you know, colonial mentality has, no, it hasn't really. You know, my research since 2006 and also other people's research since 2006, you know, haven't really shown that it's going away, which is kind of a depressing finding. And it's not just with Filipinos. Other people have used the scale or have adopted my scale for use with other peoples with, you know, similar histories of colonialism, like Puerto Ricans and Asian Indians and even people in Ghana. So people have adopted my scale for use in Ghana and found very similar results in terms of the manifestations of colonial mentality. You know, feeling ashamed, feeling embarrassed, preferring more European physical features, tolerating injustices, and also not just the manifestations of colonial mentality, but, you know, what it's related to. So even in other communities like Puerto Ricans and, you know, in Ghanaians, people are finding that colonial mentality is related to lower self-esteem and more depression symptoms. So on one hand, you know, I'm glad that, you know, my work and the scale is being adopted and being used, you know, to study the phenomenon in other communities. So I'm happy that that's happening. On the other hand, I'm not happy that they're finding the same findings as I am, you know, because it's saddening. You know, but again, I don't want to end there though, because there's actually hope, right? There are some things to do as well. I think there are many things that we can do to, you know, serve as protective factors against the internalization of oppression. So I think there's a lot of promise in that particular line of research as well.
Thank you. And John says, thanks, EJ, for the great presentation. Always nice to listen to you.
Yeah, my friend John Gonzalez, Dr. John Gonzalez, good to hear you.
Very informative and thought-provoking. Another question from Marie, what's the best way to combat racism?
Oh, wow. Well, it all, you know, if I knew that answer, wow. Again, you know, racism exists and operates in different levels. Right. So I was just talking about internalized racism, you know, there are ways that we can combat internalized racism, you know, if we realize or if we acknowledge that we, you know, might have some level of internalized racism, there's work that we can do for that. There's also work that we can do to prevent, you know, the internalization of racism. And I think things like, you know, ethnic studies, I think education, you know, there was a question about education earlier. You know, education is so powerful. You know, if education can operate to promote, reinforce, and even breed racism, I think education can also be used to combat racism. So that's, you know, to me, that's probably one of the more important ways that we can combat racism. So yeah, so there's the internalized part, there's, you know, the interpersonal part, there's the institutional part, right? Institutional racism, interpersonal racism, and internalized racism. I call them the three I's. And, you know, with education, I think education, if we do, you know, systemic changes in our educational system, in our curriculum, in our pedagogies, you know, then education really has, I think, the potential to impact racism in all three levels.
Thank you. And one more question, if you're willing.
Sure.
All right. What are some ways that we can begin to create healing within our own communities so that we can continue to fight to change the system?
Oh, wow. What are some ways we can begin to create healing? I think the first step, a very critical step would be to see our connections with other people, see our community's connections with other people, see the similarities in our struggles, you know, see how our struggles are linked to each other. I think once we start making those connections, seeing those connections and making those connections, you know, between our communities and, you know, the struggles of other communities, between our experiences and the experiences of other communities, then I think we will be in a very good position to all collectively together head toward healing.
All right, it looks like the mute button's working now. Thanks so much, EJ and everybody else for attending tonight. I think that's gonna be our last question. So please keep an eye out for any more upcoming topics through our Shine a Light speaker series at nwc.uaf.edu. or facebook.com/uaf.nwc. If you'd like to share the recording or give feedback, you can do so by visiting the courses tab at nwc.uaf.edu. Thanks again, and have a great evening.